thankful for your love and kindness. In fact, God, we pray that you'll forgive us of our sins, sins of omission, sins of commission, things that we should have done that we didn't do, and things that we didn't do that we should have done. So I'm praying that you'll bless us and forgive us and cleanse us. But now, Lord, we come before you asking in prayer for you to place your hand upon our individual lives. Oh God, I'm praying that you'll touch those who are not saved. Lord God, I'm praying that you'll touch those who are in the process of getting saved. I'm praying for those who are already saved. Lord, touch this family, this LifePoint family here, Lord God. Those who watch us online in different states. Those who are right here in the state of Georgia. I'm praying, God, that you'll bless us. Send healing and deliverance. Oh God, I'm praying that you'll open up doors, Lord God. Financial doors. Oh God, I'm praying that you'll bless us financially and spiritually. I'm praying for physical health right now, God. Have your way in these last and closing days, Lord. We need you in this house, Lord. We need your presence. We need your spirit, Father. Touch, heal, save, and deliver. Lord, I can't even mention all the names of the folks who are associated with this church. But God, I'm praying that you touch each and every person, Lord. I pray for Walter Chambers, Lord, Winston Chambers, Lord God, and Lori Ballinger, Father. I pray, Lord God, for Sonia Ford, Lord God, in the Ford family. I'm praying, God, for Sonia Mitchell in California. Oh, God, I'm praying for Alicia Wesley in California. Lord, I know they watch regularly. I'm praying for their souls right now, God. I pray, Jesus, for those who are here even today, Lord. I pray for Sister Whitney, Lord God. Lord God, I'm praying for Sister Tiffany, Lord God, and Sister Tierra. I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, for Brother Miller right now, Lord, and Sister Tony Ann and her family. God, I'm praying right now for the McCormick family, Lord God. Touch, Lord, touch Brother Richard and Sister Tracy. In the name of Jesus, touch Brother Brian Kelly, Lord God. Oh, God, touch the Milburn family, Lord God. Touch the Patton family, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And the Beattie family, Lord God. Touch all of us, Lord. All of us who need a miracle. All of us who need a hand from you. All of us who need help. Touch my dear sister Pam, Lord God. Oh, God, let your glory begin to fall. Lord, let your power begin to move. In the name of Jesus. Reach every home, Lord. Touch every house. Lord, touch us right now. Touch our bodies to feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Touch Mother July right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, God, touch right now, Lord. Every person who comes through these doors, I'm praying that your hand of mercy and your hand of grace will rest upon them. And every name I haven't mentioned, you know them by name, Lord God. You know the amount of hairs on their head. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus. Lord God, touch them now. Touch them now, Father. Touch them now, Lord God. Heal, save, and deliver. Set free in a mighty fashion. In a mighty way. Move, Lord God. And we'll be careful to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. We thank you right now for healing. We thank you for deliverance. We thank you for a way out. We thank you for the Holy Ghost power. Touch us right now. And we give you praise right now, Father. In Jesus' name. Come on, somebody say it with me. In Jesus' name. Now clap those hands and give God some praise in the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Thank you,
we're
Jesus.
We're going to be getting ready for our offering. Thank for those of you who are here in the house, you know the drill. You can go ahead and come on up and give in the offering plate. And, of course, those of you who are watching online, you can give by way of Cash App. That should be on your screen. Or you can also give by going to our website and clicking on the donate button. But I do want to make mention of something very quickly while you're giving. I want to make mention that before the song starts. We have here, this is Generation to Generation, which is a Save Our Children campaign. And this is to help children's ministries. I mentioned this a couple of weeks ago. Children's ministries. As I mentioned before, I know that I personally received the Holy Ghost at a children's camp meeting. My daughter received the Holy Ghost at a children's camp meeting. My son received one at a camp meeting many years ago, some time ago. And so these camps are beneficial to your children. It teaches them about the word of the Lord and about God. And so there are some cards in the back. Brother Richard, if you can just, you know, hand those out. If anyone wants them, raise your hand. Again, it has an amount on it, but you can give whatever you want to. And it goes toward the children's ministry for the United Pentecostal Church International. Some of you have already given. And I appreciate that. Thank God for that. But for those of you who have not yet given, if you want to participate, by all means, you can do so. And on the back, it mentions that you can some things you can pray about, things you can get involved in, and things you can give toward. And of course, you can just write your name on there. And if you don't have it today, but you want to give later, you can go ahead and take a card, write your name down and what you want to give, and put it in the offering plate, and you can give that money later. But again, it's for the benefit of our children, part of the United Pentecostal Church International. Very quickly, I do also want to mention that this Tuesday evening, we will be having missionary Gibbs. He and his wife and daughter will be visiting with us all the way from Malawi. And they will be coming to speak and talk about their desire and their ministry they had out there in Malawi. And so if you're able to make it out this Tuesday night, by all means, come on out this Tuesday night and receive a blessing from the Lord. You know, oftentimes they will come and they bring videos and paperwork or pamphlets and whatnot of what's going on over there. So please make sure you come out. And if not, make sure you watch us online. In Jesus' name. Very quickly, I know I'm taking up time. Very quickly, one last thing. I do want to make mention that we are also setting up ministries. I was speaking with someone the other week, and I mentioned to them that we are preparing different ministries for the church. And so as some of you know, we've been getting some new folks this year. We have our quote-unquote older saints, who are still watching online, many of which who are still waiting for some things to happen before they come back. But there are some new folks who've been attending services this year, and we're so thankful for you being here. Amen. But we will be having, in the near future, I will have a list of ministries that people can get involved in and volunteer for. You can pick and choose and get involved and do some great things to benefit the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. God is doing great things here at Life Point, and I want you to be a part of it. Let's get ready for all, as we give it our offering and as we sing another song in Jesus' name.
You baptize me with your spirit and the gift of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues? Was it like fire shut up in your bones? Is it still that way today? Hallelujah, glory to God. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. I can honestly say that it is like that for me today. Almost 38 years later. Hallelujah, glory to God. It is like fire shut up in my bones. And I'm so happy to be in the midst of God's people this morning. Let's welcome Pastor McCormick as he prepares to preach the word of God to us. Let's welcome him with a hearty word of amen. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Why don't you give the Lord a shout of praise in this place? Hallelujah. Thank you again, Grace. Wonderful job. We're so happy that you're able to usher in the presence of the Lord. So we're so thankful. Amen. Amen. And of course, we want to thank God for all of our. If there are any first-time guests, by all means, feel free to fill out a guest card so that we can go ahead and take record of who's visiting our churches. And of course, we would love for you to come back and visit with us again if the Lord says the same. Hallelujah. There should be a card on the chair, on the back of the chair in front of you, and there might even be a pen somewhere on those one of those chairs as well, so you can fill it out, and then you can put it in that offering plate, or you can give it to Brother Richard on the back. Amen. And we'll be glad to have that. Amen. All right. Without any further ado, we're going to jump right into the word of the Lord this morning. Pray the Lord. If you have your Bibles, or if not, maybe you have your phone or a tablet, or you can look on the screen. We'll be looking in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 55. Isaiah chapter 55. Amen. Isn't God good?
Amen.
He's a good God. He's kept us all year long last year, and we're starting to see some blessings begin to happen even this year. And we know that we are not in this thing for long. The pandemic is not over yet, but it's not here to stay. And so we are so happy that the Lord's hand is on us and keeping us through it all. Amen. We have something to praise God about. Amen.
Amen.
If you're still here, if your family's still alive, if you hadn't gotten sick, or if you did get sick, but God got you through it, you got something to give God thanks for. Amen. Isaiah chapter 55 and verse number 1. The Bible says, just one verse of scripture. It says, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come buy wine and milk," I want you to focus on this, "without money and without price. Come buy, even though you have no money, because there is no price. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price." And I want to preach to you this morning a message entitled, "No Charge." No charge. If we can, those of you who are sitting to give honor to God, if we can stand as you give it and pray, just a brief prayer for the Lord to touch us today. Amen. Amen. We know that the word of God is already anointed, Father, but we ask that you will anoint your servant to speak to your people. And I pray that you will anoint the ears of your people to hear what you have to say. Touch us, Lord God, as we venture into the word, that we will leave this place better than how we walked in, that healing and deliverance and salvation will come our way, and that, God, we might have an opportunity to receive all that you have to give us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of the King. Why don't you give the Lord a hand clap of praise one more time? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. No charge. No charge. You know, years ago, Shirley Caesar sang a song. Those of you who've been saved a while may know this song, but it's a song where a little boy handed his mother a piece of paper. And on this paper, the boy wrote, he wrote, $5 for mowing the yard. Then he said, $2 for raking the yard. $1 for making my bed. 25 cents for playing with my little brother. And $3 for finishing my homework. Total owed $11.25. Well, the mother picked up the same pen, and she wrote on the other side of that same piece of paper, and she said, "For the 9 months I carried you, no charge. For the nights I sat up doctoring and praying for you, no charge. For the time and tears and costs through the years, no charge. For the advice and the knowledge and for the price and cost for college, no charge. And then she wrote at the very end, when you add it all up, the real cost of my love is no charge. You know, and this song sums up how loving parents feel about their children. But more importantly, how God feels about us. That, you know, we're willing to do whatever it takes to be a blessing to our children, knowing we may not get anything back in return. And God is the primary individual who exemplifies this attitude of love, that he will do whatever he needs to do, whatever he can do, knowing he won't get much back in response. But he does it because of his love for us. Now I personally believe that God rather enjoys sustaining us. He enjoys taking care of us and loving us. In fact, I believe that his hope is that we'll appreciate, or rather approach him thirsting for the satisfaction of salvation, and to take what he's offering without payment. He doesn't want any money back. He doesn't want anything back, really. He's just asking for our heart. And so he's willing to give it to us, knowing that we don't have much to give back in return. I mean, let's be honest. There's not enough money in the world to pay God back for all the things he's done for us. Am I by myself on that? When you really think of all the things God has done for you, even before you were actually born, what he did for you in the womb, the things he did for you when you were asleep, the things he did when you didn't know trouble was on its way to your house, all the things he's done for you, there is not enough money to pay God back. David said, "What shall I render unto the Lord for his good works toward the children of men?" There is nothing I can really pay God back with other than myself. And so God's actions detail the level in which he wants to take care of his own. He desires to take care of us. He desires to watch over us. He desires to sustain us. And we see in God's life, or rather in Jesus' life, and how that God became man and did all that he did, we see the level and the extent, the measure of God's love. We see how far God would go to save just you and I. This is why the Apostle Paul exhorts in the book of Ephesians chapter 1 and verse number 3. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ," watch this, "who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings." Can you say that with me? He's blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Yes, he has. All spiritual blessings. Come on, turn around and tell your neighbor, just point to him and say to your neighbor, "You're blessed. You're blessed. In fact, you're better than blessed." Come on, say it with me. You are better than blessed. You're blessed. You're highly favored. You're blessed coming in and going out. You're blessed in the city and in the field. God's before you, behind you, above you, beside you, beneath you. You are blessed by Jesus. And if you don't think you are, you need to wake up and smell the roses and realize, you know what? God is the creator. He's my savior. He's my deliverer. He is a good God. Even if I don't think so, he's still good to me. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessing. I, you know, it's funny because when we talk about spiritual blessing, yes, we're discussing the gift of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit, you know, healing and faith and miracles and signs and whatnot. You know, we're talking about the fivefold ministry and all these things that God, the anointing and the favor of God, all these things that God has bestowed on us, you know, every good gift that cometh down from the Father of lights. But here's the thing, spiritual blessings are often manifested in the natural. They're manifested in a physical way. So yes, you may get spiritual blessings, but you don't always recognize the blessings in the spirit realm until it manifests itself in your body through healing or in your life through deliverance. Let me give you a quick testimony. Some of you probably don't know this, but in February, I was laid off from my job. I'd been there for almost 11 years on this job, and I did a good job. They loved me, everyone loved me, but there came a time because of the pandemic that they felt they needed to let me go because they didn't bring in enough customers or clients, and so they had no way to continue paying me. Along with some other folks, they had to let us all go. And so I was out of a job from the middle of February. I didn't complain. I didn't cry about it. I didn't even worry. I said, you know what? God's got this under control. So for the next month and a half, until the end of March and the beginning of April, I decided I'm going to go ahead and study, because right now I currently have what's called a general license in the United Pentecostal Church International. And the next level up is a license of ordination. And so I decided to study for this license of ordination. And it took some 6 weeks. All the 6 weeks I had to study, and I had to read at least one book a week. And these books are some 500 pages or more. And I had to watch six videos with each book, and I had to take a test that coincided with each video and with each book, rather. And there were 10 books altogether, so there were 10 times I had to read a very large book and watch several videos and take a test. And I did this. I worked hard at it, and I was able to finish it by the end and the beginning of March and April. Well, you know, I thought to myself, well, what do I need to do now? You know, I need to figure out something else to do. And I wasn't even concerned about the job. I knew God was going to bless me. Well, it turns out that someone, a former coworker of mine who quit the job that I was on for 11 years, she quit it 2 years ago. And she calls me out of the blue and says, Mike, do you need a job? Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, I do. Well, I have a job for you. Can you, you know, I want to offer this job to you. And here's the thing. It was a good job, a decent paying job. But I said to myself, after praying about it and talking to my wife about it, I said, you know what? My daughter, she's working too, but I'd like for her to take this position because I think it'd be good for her to get her foot in the door. And so I offered it to my daughter. My daughter was like, yes, please. And so I went back to the job and I said to the young lady, I said, listen, won't you give this job to my daughter? Because right now I'm home and I'm working with my mother and doing some things, helping her out and helping my sister out. And so why don't you just go ahead and give it to my daughter? And they said, you know what? We'll do that. Well, the following week they called me back and they said, listen, we're going to give your daughter this other position because we really want you, Michael, for this position. And I said, well, I already told you, I need to be available to help my mom and my sister out because of her condition. And they said, well, how about this? How about we let you work from home? Now, I already know most folks are working from home anyway. I understand that. That's not a big deal. I get that. But here's the point. She came looking for me. The blessings of the Lord were overtaking me because I didn't seek it. They sought me. But here's the greater thing. The greatest thing is I finished all of my studying by the end of March and the beginning of April. By April the 2nd, I sent off an email to my presbyter or my bishop to let him know that I concluded all the tests and I'm ready to take my license, and that will be in July. Well, she received my number from someone on my job prior to that I used to work on. They gave her my number on March the 15th. And she said, I've been struggling whether or not I should call you. I didn't even have your number, but I got your number 3 weeks ago. And I was wondering, should I call you about this? Because I didn't know if you even needed anything. And so God allowed me to continue and finish the studying I needed to do in order to advance my ministerial career, so that then when I'm done, she calls me 3 weeks after, when I was exactly done doing the prayer and the studying and the fasting and the reading, so that she now provides something for me after the fact. All I'm saying is, God knows how to bless. There were things happening in the spirit realm that I was unaware of until it manifested itself in my life. And so now I know that God's will is at hand, because these folks are bending backwards for me and my daughter. Come on, somebody. When you are blessed of the Lord, the blessings of God will literally overtake you. Turn around and tell somebody, you're blessed. You're better than blessed. Songwriter said, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And so I think it is imperative that we acknowledge that everything we receive from God is without price. You need to understand that. The value of God's love, His supervision and intervention exceed any amount of money you might have. I don't care if you're Donald Trump. I don't care if you're Oprah Winfrey. I don't care how rich or how much money. I don't care if you're the king of this or that. I don't care who you are. You don't have enough cash in hand or in the bank to pay for your own salvation. So God said I would do it without charge. Someone say no charge. You know, I recently discovered that it was a woman by the name of Elvina Hall who penned the words to this song, a well-known hymn. She wrote, Jesus paid it all. Anybody know that song? All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed me white as snow. And she wrote this song several hundred years ago. And if you're glad to know that Jesus paid it all, just wave your hands or clap your hands or do something and recognize that God paid it all for you. I don't know what Miss Hall was going through, but she went through something enough to write this word and let us know that Jesus paid it all for her. Whatever she was going through, the Lord paid it for her. And so it should be no surprise to you, however. I do want to make mention of this as a caveat. There should be no surprise to you that normally people are used to paying their own bills. They're used to paying for everything. That's just how it is. In fact, most folks feel that if you come to me and say, I want to give this to you for free, your first statement, I'm from New York. And you know, and from New York, we don't play that. If you come in and give me something for free, what's the catch? There's got to be a catch, because folks don't give nothing for free. What's in the small print? I need to know what the small print says. Because if you're giving me something for free, there's got to be a reason. There's got to be some catch. But no, Jesus wants to bless us. And so most people are used to having to pay for things. You know, it's funny. I was witnessing to a young lady by the name of Lori Ballinger. We mentioned her name in prayer earlier. And her relative in Florida reached out to me and asked me to teach her home Bible study. And so I started going over her home and with her family. And I was teaching her Bible study. This was some years ago. And her father, who was at that time in his 80s, he's passed and gone now. But he approached me and said, "Sir, young man, what do you have to do with my daughter? Why are you coming over here? Well, why are you so interested in my daughter?" Now, she wasn't married, you know, she was single, living in the house. And he said, why are you interested in my daughter? And I said, well, first of all, I'm married, saved and sanctified, got a family of my own, so I don't want her like that. But I'm here because I'm trying to win her soul to Christ. Wait. So you have no ulterior motives? You don't want no money? No, sir. You're not trying to scam us? No, sir. You're not trying to rob us? No, sir. You don't want us to join your church? Only if you want to. But I'm here to talk to her and hopefully you about the word of God. It was all meant as a means to pull her into Christ. And so some people, when they see that you're getting stuff for free, they wonder. They start thinking something's wrong. But that's why you got to come to Jesus. Because Jesus says, everything I give you is without cost. Everything I bestow on you is without money. You don't need to worry about it. I got it paid for you. It's always been that way that folks are concerned about their money. Even there's a scripture found in the First Chronicles chapter 21 that discusses the nation of Israel being punished because of King David's sin, for example. David had committed one of his many sins and God was punishing him for it. Well, God said that in order for the punishment to cease, that an altar must be built on a particular piece of land. And so, as it turns out, David had an opportunity, watch this, he had an opportunity to accept this land for free. Now, you know, if it was me, I'd say thank you very much. But David is a king. David is the richest man in the land. And David said, I don't need your charity. I can pay for this 10 times over. And so when David was in that position, he felt compelled to say in 1 Chronicles chapter 21 and verse 24, he said, "Nay, but I will verily buy it for the full price. For I will not take that which is thine for the Lord, nor offer burnt offerings without cost. I'm not going to do it. I refuse to take this for free." You see, even though King David is being reprimanded for his sinful actions, understand, it was his guilt that prompted him to pay for this land. It was his guilt. But here's the thing. You see, I want you to notice that like Jesus Christ, in this particular instance, in this particular time, David does resemble Christ in that David recognized that somebody is required to pay for whatever benefits are received. Do you understand what I'm saying? In other words, it might be free to you, but somebody had to pay for it. Yeah, yeah. It's free to me, but somebody along the way had to pay some kind of price for me to get what I call free. You see, now Jesus wasn't guilty of any sin, but he did take on our sins, and he decided to pay the price for you and I. I don't know about you, but I am so glad that Jesus decided to pay the price for my sins. If I was the only man on earth, he still would have died for me. I'm glad that God decided to come down in the form of man and die for my sins. He paid the price that I could not pay. He paid the price that I had no money to pay. He paid the price that I could not afford. He did that just for me. Now, let me remind you that in our scripture text originally in Isaiah 55, it said that we can obtain what we need from the Lord to survive without paying for it. The Bible says that. That's what we read in our first scripture, Isaiah 55 and verse 1. But we must conclude that in order to get something for free, as I said, somebody else had to pay that bill. Somebody has got to pay that thing. You know, when you go to school and you send your child to public school and you think to yourself, well, I'm not paying for this, it's free. Well, somebody's paying those teacher salaries. They're getting paid for, somebody is paying the price. Anytime the church gives away free things, we used to give away, you know, coupons and little credit cards with $50 on it. And we used to give away things. Well, you know what? You got it for free, but we had to pay for it. So anything you get for free, somebody paid the price. Well, the good news is that Jesus willingly paid the price for our salvation, because like King David, Jesus knew that the benefits outweigh the cost. Can I say that again? The benefits outweigh the cost. Yeah. Whatever is benefit, however you benefit from this thing, the cost is worth it. It's worth it. It's worth it to pay, no matter how much I have to pay to make sure that you gain the benefit. You know, it was years ago that I learned that it is often better to pay a higher price for something of greater quality than to spend cheaply on something that will soon break down. Some of you don't get what I'm saying, you know. When I was younger in marriage, when we first got married, you know, we were on a budget, you know. We were on a budget. We first got married, we were on a budget. Amen. Little budget, yes, little budget. And so, you know, what I used to do, and I thought I was so smart, I used to go ahead and I'd buy everything generic. Yeah, I'd buy the cheapest thing I could find. And then some of you, if you buy shampoo cheap, you know, it doesn't work all the time, but you buy it anyway. You buy everything cheap. And so when I bought it for cheap, I was able to get more quantity for less money. I thought, man, I'm a smart brother. Yeah, I'm a good husband. I'm smart. I'm bringing home all this stuff, bags and bags of groceries. Yeah, it's cheap, but we got bags and bags of stuff. And, you know, but it took a while, and eventually I started noticing that the cheap stuff don't work. Cheap stuff don't last. I'd go buy my pants and my shoes, and I get it for real cheap. I get the no-name brand, and I say, it's all right. I'm a grown man. I got nobody. I'm fine. And you buy these cheap shoes and these cheap pair of pants, and here's the thing. You know, cheap pants rip. Cheap shoes get holes in them real quick. And so it took me a while to figure out it's better to pay the price. It's better to go ahead and spend a little more money and buy something of greater quality, so that it will last you longer. Jesus said, listen, I'm not going to spend just a little bit of money on you. I'm not going to spend anything small on you. I'm going to do the greatest and the best, because I realize that this is going to be something that will last forever. But the Bible tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19, it says, for as much as ye know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold. In other words, God didn't redeem us with money, honey. God didn't redeem us with silver or gold or cash or anything that will be depleted. He did not redeem us with that, but no, rather God redeemed us with the precious blood of Christ himself. Can someone shout hallelujah right there? Jesus realized, I got to pay the full price. I can't do this thing half-heartedly. I can't go this halfway. I got to make sure I do the whole thing. I can't let Moses die, because his death won't do nothing for me. I can't let Daniel die, because his death won't do nothing for you. I can't let Paul die because Paul's death won't do. Martin Luther King, thank you for what you did, but your death can't save me. All the matriarchs and martyrs and patriarchs of the past, their death, I appreciate what they did and what they went through, but those lives didn't save me. I needed somebody who had more than money. I needed somebody who had more than just life. I needed somebody who could die and rise again. I needed somebody who could come where I am and deliver me from where I am to live in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. So I needed somebody who knew I can die, but I'm going to rise once again. And I needed Jesus Christ because he redeemed us by paying the ultimate price, which was his own life. Aren't you glad that Jesus died and used his own life as payment for you? Because of this, we have access to healing. We have access to deliverance and eternal salvation. Yes, because of what Jesus did on the cross, you and I have access to more of God. Let me give you some more detail on what the Lord did. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 53, verses 3 through 5, it says that Jesus Christ, he is despised and rejected of men. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. We hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken and smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Then verse 7 says, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he did not open his mouth. Verse 10 says, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for our sin, then he shall see his seed, that's you and I. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. In other words, what happened here is that the God of heaven and earth, the creator of the whole universe, humbled himself and became a man to save mankind. Can someone shout hallelujah? He said, I'm willing to give up my life for yours. I'm willing to do what I got to do for you. I'll give up my throne in glory just so that you will have a gospel story. I'm so glad that God loved me enough to die on a rugged cross. Yes, they hung him high and they stretched him wide. He hung his head, and for you and me, he died. But that's not how the story ends. For 3 days later, he rose again. I'm talking to somebody that the Lord gave himself up just for you. Come on, somebody. So when you think on how he was falsely accused for your sins, you ought to be thankful that he didn't charge it against your account. When you visualize how he was beaten on your behalf, remember that it was at no charge. The next time you ponder about him hanging on a cross until he died, he did it at no cost to you. If anyone cried over the notion that he was buried in a tomb, don't you worry, the tomb was borrowed. There was no charge. The fact that we still rejoice over his resurrection in the that you appreciate his sacrifice when the gospel is heard and readily accepted is because Jesus paid the price. If you decide to be buried with Christ through baptism in the name of Jesus, it's because there's no cost and it won't cost you a thing. And when with outstretched arms and eyes toward heaven you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, it's because this Holy Ghost power is given freely. There is no charge. No sir, no ma'am. You can come to this altar with no money. You can come to this altar with no cash in hand. Just come with your heart open, your eyes wide open to Jesus, and call on him, and he will deliver you. No cost. No charge. Come on, somebody say that. No charge. No charge, yeah. It didn't cost me a thing. It just cost me my heart. I didn't have to come with no money or cash. I just came with my, I come with something everyone has, a heart, a desire to serve God. You see, God is an equalizer. He says, you can come to me if you're poor or rich, black or white, man or woman, adult or child. It doesn't matter. You can come to me and give me your heart Give me your soul. And so everything that God did for us was for your benefit. I'm closing. He did all the work and paid all your bills. It was no charge to you. But you do owe him your life. You do owe him your life, though. There's no charge for it. But after you get it, you do owe God your life. If you want the Holy Ghost, or if you want to get baptized in Jesus' name, this is the time to give him your life. And if you're already saved, come on, let's all stand. If you're already saved, just lift your hands and begin to praise God for the sacrifice he made. Come on, somebody, let's worship the Lord as they play, as we get ready to dismiss in a few moments. But I want you to understand that Jesus loves you. He cares enough for you that he died on the cross. I know Easter was last week, but I feel that the preachers today, that God, that Jesus, rather, he died on the cross, and there was no charge to you. No charge. If someone came to you and said, listen, I want to take you out to lunch, and you said, you know what, I'd love to, but I'm kind of broke this week. I got to save my money. That's okay. I'll pay for it. Some of you are too proud, and you wouldn't accept it. I'm not like that. I don't do that. If you offer to pay for me, let's go. Where are we going? Where are we going? How much can I spend? You know, we going to Red Lobster? We going to Olive Garden? Where are we going? McDonald's? Just let me know. Let me know the limits. And so God is saying, listen, I got you. I'm paying for everything. Well, what's the limits? There aren't any limits. It's limitless. I'm paying for everything. Well, what do I have to do? Just show up. And then what? Just lift your hands. Open your mouth. And receive him. Just thank him for what he's getting ready to do in your life. And you can receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Is there anybody this afternoon who'd like to come down in prayer? We'll pray with you. We'll leave God with you. That God will touch your heart. And for those of you who are watching online, right where you are, just lift your hands. Whether you're in California or here in Georgia, maybe you're in Florida, just lift those hands and begin to magnify his name and thank him for all the things he's already done in your life. And start asking for God to fill you with his presence. Fill you with his glory. Hallelujah. But for those here, the altars are open. We're going to sing in just a second. But the altars are open. If you want to come down, we'll pray with you in Jesus' name.
Silencing my head.
To flow in their lives, Lord, as they give themselves to you completely. Oh God, I pray that you'll touch their inward heart, touch their inward parts, Lord, touch their soul. Oh God, touch them from their soul to their heart, touch their mind, oh God. Help them, Father, reach out to you, to cry out to you, to cry out for the Holy Ghost power. Oh God, touch them now, Lord. Anoint them, Father, to be your grace and your mercy and your love and your strength. Come on, somebody. Come on, worship the Lord with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
The
power of God is on
one. Jesus, the God who brings the way to life. You're the God of miracles. You're the God.
You can sing this song. We cannot forget the reason why we're here.
Come on.
Come on, sing real soft, sing real soft. Don't forget the reason why we're here. Maybe some of you are here to hear a great message. I don't know. Maybe you're here because you're out of obligation. Maybe somebody dragged you here. Maybe you're here because you know you should do this. Maybe you came to see who's going to be here. I don't know why you came. But the main reason we come here is so that we can either get saved or stay saved. We come here so we can pray together, touch heaven together, pray for each other, believe God to keep us going. There are souls who need the Holy Ghost, who need God. And I want you to understand, I don't want you leaving here thinking that there's nothing to this. I don't want you leaving here thinking that, oh, I got time. And technically you do, but I want you to understand that time is not on your side. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to help you to realize time is not on your side.
That's right.
If you're here, you've got to reach out. When you come to church, you ought to come with your hands raised, with your mouth open with a praise, waiting and anticipating for God to bless you. I know you go to some churches, and I know, I get it. It's a social club, I get it. You come and you network and you connect, and that's all, you know, wonderful for those churches. But for us, I prayed this morning.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. We fast during the week.
Hallelujah.
We touch heaven's gate. We pray that God will heal your body and save your soul. We're not here playing games. We're here because we want you saved. I'm trying to drag folks into heaven. I'm trying to reach people to pull them out of the flame of fire and pull you into heaven. You know if you're right or not. You know. I don't have to tell you. And I'm not here to judge anybody because I've been right where you are. And sometimes I'm there again and again and again. But I've learned to repent. I've learned to talk to God. I've learned to get on my face before the Lord. And I'm trying my best to make it in. And I want to see you there when I get there. Because I'm going. I want to see you there when I get to heaven. Hallelujah. So one more time. Before we go, one more time. Lift those hands. God is speaking right now. God is speaking right here, right now. Come on, get quiet. God is talking. God is talking. Jesus. Jesus. For those of you who don't understand, the Bible talks about tongues, the gift of tongues and interpretation. And during that period of time where the gift of tongues interpretation happens, as just now, someone will speak in tongues in a heavenly language, and either that same person or someone else will interpret what the Lord just said to you in that heavenly language. This is not something we planned or go to school to learn. This is the Holy Ghost. This is the presence of God. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. God is talking to your heart. You should feel privileged, honored that God decided to visit us today, that he spoke to you today. As I said, he's coming back, and the Lord just said it. He's coming back soon, and it's for us to be ready and prepare our hearts. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, lift those hands. In holy silence, just lift those hands. Everybody lift those hands and begin to thank God for speaking to our hearts. Thank you for speaking to our hearts. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to also understand, while your hands are raised, I want you to understand that the gift of tongues is different than the gift of the Holy Ghost. The gift of the Holy Ghost, you do speak in tongues, but that is a sign that the Lord has filled your heart and your soul with his presence, with his spirit. The gift of tongues only happens if you already have the Holy Ghost. And the gift of tongues is for a specific purpose, to speak to the church. But the gift of the Holy Ghost is a sign to you and to those around you that the power and presence of God has now entered your physical body. So don't think that you have to interpret or anything of that nature. Just understand that if you're praying with your hands raised and you want God to fill you with the Holy Ghost, you might hear some words in your head that you don't understand. That's okay. Let God have his way. Let God begin to speak through you. Let God talk through you. And that is a sign that his presence and his power has filled your life. Come on, lift those hands. Is there anyone who wants the Holy Ghost? He's here. You can stand right here, and I'll pray with you one last time before we dismiss. I know time is up. I know we got to go. But your soul is more important. Hallelujah. Anybody before we go? Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, I want to thank God. We're going to pray in a minute, but I want to thank God for speaking to our hearts. You don't know how important that is. How important. The Bible tells us that between the book of Malachi and the book of Matthew, for 400 some years, no one heard the voice of God. No one. The Bible says in the book of Judges, it says in the beginning of the book of Judges, that the voice of God was very limited in that time. No one really heard the voice of God. And because of that, people did whatever they thought was right in their eyes. But when God speaks to us, he's reminding us that he's still watching. He's reminding us that he's still in charge. He's reminding us that he still loves us. So this is your opportunity, while he is still in the atmosphere, to just praise him. In fact, whatever you need from the Lord, now's a good time to ask him for it, because he's still here. He's still here. Now's a good time to ask him for it. That miracle you need, that healing you need, that deliverance you're longing for, now's a good time. Real quick, ask him for it before he leaves. Ask him for it. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you will begin to grant blessings, grant answers, Lord God. Heal, deliver, set free, save right now, Father. I'm praying that you'll touch every head of this in this house, Lord God. Every person watching online, Lord God, touch right now, Father. Touch right now, God, wherever they are. Lord, speak those words into our hearts again, that we can leave this place better than how we walked in. Touch us, Father. Hallelujah. Yes, yes. That's all right. That's all right. Let God talk to you. Let God deal with your heart. That's it. That's it. Hallelujah.
Yes, he's
And the Lord sees. He sees where you are. If you're in sin, he sees it. If you're trying to serve him, he sees that. Whatever you need, he sees your need. And so we can't hide from God, y'all. We can't. We might as well just give it up to Jesus. Let him have control. He sees everything we're going through, everything we're doing. So we might as well give it up to the Lord. Hallelujah. Before you all leave, I see some of you on the back ready to leave. Before you leave, Heavenly Father, touch us right now, God. You have already spoken to us. And we are so grateful and thankful that you spoke to us, Lord. And I pray that these words, the words that you've spoken, will sit in our hearts and draw us closer to the cross. I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you'll touch the saints of old. Lord God, those who are here, who are established and who love you, touch us, Lord God, to continue walking by faith. Those who are in the process of getting saved, those who have been baptized but haven't received the Holy Ghost yet, or those who have the Holy Ghost and haven't been baptized yet, I pray that you will convict our hearts, their hearts, to continue in the process. I pray for those, Lord, who are not saved at all, that they will have a desire to seek you like the very breath they breathe. Oh God, help us to seek you like the air we breathe, Lord. I'm praying that your glory would continue to follow us home. Follow us to our separate homes, Lord God. Oh God, touch us now. Let the Holy Ghost be here on Tuesday night as we have a missionary speaking the same word. Lord, bless us as we go our separate ways. Anoint us and use us for your glory. I'm praying for salvation. I'm praying for healing and deliverance. Have your way, God. Have your way, Father. And God, as we get ready to go, feel free to continue speaking to our hearts. Feel free to continue talking to our hearts, Lord. All the way home. Talk to us, Lord. Talk to us. Talk to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, somebody said, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God bless you. If you can leave, by all means, go ahead. But if you're a guest, first-time guest, please don't go until I bump elbows with you. I love you. I want to see who you are. But God bless you in Jesus' name.
Okay, tell me. Okay, tell me. Okay, tell me.